A very pleasant good evening to all our viewers. Welcome to this edition of Muslim American Perspectives, where we make an earnest effort, a persistent effort, I would say, to bridge the ever-widening gulf between Islam and Christian faith, or some people would like to prefer it called Christianity. I would be amiss if I did not mention the Pontiff, Papa Francis, who is here in the United States, and the way he eulogized this great nation, the land of the free and the brave. Every heart was touched. Here is a country which is a land of immigrants, and I am beneficiary of that. This country opened its doors, the people opened their arms, and people like me have been welcomed, and our dreams have come true. And why not become part of this great culture instead of calling this nation, calling the values and culture of this land of the free and brave a decadent society, a sexually charged society? Because then the children listen to that and they grow up in the home hating. And I use the word again, hating the values of this great nation. Sometimes I have been asked, and I have hundreds of thousands of Muslims who are my friends, that where is the breeding ground? And I very openly and very sincerely tell them, it's the home, home. With that said, I am going to talk again a little bit about the Pope. He exuded, when he eulogized this great nation, he exuded hope, grace, and love. Let's share that message. Love, hope, and grace. Once we do that, we would be a one nation under God. Yes, faith is very important in some culture. Your religion is first, your family is number two, and your nationality is way down the road, number three or last one. So my friends, it's very important, of paramount importance, that we take pride to be called, I am American. I belong to this country. But today, we are very fortunate to have a guest. And my guest is Reverend Nicolas Cammacho. Welcome. Reverend Cammacho, we have something in common. Yes. You have been to Afghanistan.
Yes, sir.
And I have crossed on foot from northern Pakistan into Afghanistan many, many times. Mm-hmm. And so we are going to learn a lot about Islamic faith, Islamic society, Islamic culture, because as an American, he lived there. He was army chaplain, and from close quarters, he was able to see the culture, see the values. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much
for
being on this show. Tell us, Reverend Cammacho, tell us, when you were in Afghanistan, mm-hmm. how did you find the people and their values, and also how you were treated when you were away from the base?
Well, I went there in 2010 mm-hmm. as part of a group of army soldiers mm-hmm. that we were tasked mm-hmm. to go to Afghanistan and serve under order commands. Mm-hmm. When we got there, I was assigned to put together volunteers in mission mm-hmm. Program that was primarily to provide humanitarian and charitable services mm-hmm. to supply the needs.
Humanitarian services. Yes. And America was providing charitable services.
Services. Mm-hmm. So my task was to identify different organizations around the city of Kabul, from the north to the south and the north and the east.
Mm-hmm. So it was not just invading Afghanistan but provision of charitable
yes, sir.
Efforts, you know, in the form of food, medicine, etc.,
yeah.
etc.
School Go supplies ahead. And everything. So during that, I was able to make contact with what was the Afghan National Army Hospital mm-hmm. that was behind our compound. Mm-hmm. A compound means in the aspects of military vocabulary, yeah. a place where the soldiers are located. Mm-hmm. And there was the Afghan Children Hospital mm-hmm. that was also walking distance. Mm-hmm. And then from there, I was able to identify three school sites, mm-hmm. Three daycares, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And two villages, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we focused on those areas, and we were able to identify and build up relationship with the leaders of those areas, mm-hmm. And they helped us to look into what were the specific needs that they were lacking from.
Mm-hmm. So that said beautifully, we are still there.
Yes, sir.
And here and there, our soldiers, young soldiers, American soldiers, NATO soldiers are killed by the same soldiers that, Afghani soldiers that they have trained. They mm-hmm. turn back. So why is that here? America mm-hmm. is providing them and modern mm-hmm. facilities, schools, and why do they hate America?
Well, I can say in my own sincere opinion and experience, every soldier that goes to, there was one of the struggling questions. Mm-hmm. For so many hundreds and thousands of soldiers. Mm-hmm. I will not deny to you that I struggle with mm-hmm. with that as well. Mm-hmm. But the fact of seeing the daily needs of the society there, kids getting up in the mornings, mm-hmm. walking shoeless, mm-hmm. a mile or 2 miles to the school,
right.
Parents, fathers coming out of the house, mm-hmm. with no chances of getting food. Mm-hmm. I can tell you my experience was an experience in where the African community welcomed me. Mm-hmm. They opened the doors. Mm-hmm. Every time I was going out mm-hmm. with a team of mm-hmm. 7 or 15 soldiers, at least as a minimum, mm-hmm. We were getting to the places, and they were the ones opening their arms, receiving us, welcoming us, mm-hmm. and spending time with us. Mm-hmm. And I was able to see that the common needs that I was having here in America about family issues, mm-hmm. family situation, mm-hmm. they were having it too.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, that said, that is wonderful. And thank you for enlightening yeah. us. Now let's turn back to here yeah. in US. And people like me, mm-hmm. as the recipient of everything that this nation, great nation, freedoms, every kind of freedom that you can dream
mm-hmm.
is here. So what would be the responsibility of people like me? Mm-hmm. My name is Mahmood, M-A-H-M-O-O-D, but Mahmood. But I am not Muslim, I am Christian. And so what is our responsibility when this country has opened its doors? Is it okay to assimilate? Is it okay to integrate? Is it okay to amalgamate in this society?
If we look to bring everybody to assimilate, then we will be taking away from that individual the freedom
mm-hmm.
to be and to practice and
mm-hmm.
to believe.
Mm-hmm.
We can have different opinions and different practices on our own faith belief and religious practices.
Mm-hmm.
But I understand that I should know you
mm-hmm.
and I should value what you bring into.
Yes.
And there should be a common, consistent dialogue.
Yes.
That will bring my insights and your insights, and together we will be able to see that we are human beings created.
Right, exactly.
Why?
When you said that, what we bring in.
Yes.
Okay. God Almighty,
mm-hmm.
creator of all humankind, has endowed us with talents
mm-hmm.
and skills,
mm-hmm.
God-given talents. When we come here to this land of the free and the brave, is it not our responsibility to bring and add those skills and talents so that we can make this nation bigger, better, and more beautiful?
Yes, certainly.
Certainly.
Yes, certainly. Yes.
So it's all right to practice your own religion, because in this country you can practice your mm-hmm. own faith in your own way. But there is somewhere you have to invest your skills, invest your talents in this great nation.
Mm-hmm.
So coming back, I still feel that we all, people who are newly arrived
mm-hmm.
with different faiths, practice your own faith, but give your talents to this nation. Because yeah. immigrants came,
yes.
I believe in melting pot.
Yes.
What is a melting pot? Each alloy has its own strength.
Mm-hmm.
So when different alloys come, you know, in the form of immigrant,
mm-hmm.
they're all in this melting pot, and that makes it more beautiful and very, very strong, potent
melting pot.
Melting that anyway. And if that happens, that is why I believe this nation is called, I have to mention President Reagan, shining city on a hill.
Yes.
Now, we hear about all the violence.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I am going to come back to this violence. Why there is violence against Christian minority beginning from Turkey?
Mm-hmm.
The Islamic Belt, Iran, Iraq, Middle East, Saudi Arabia, mm-hmm. even Pakistan, Afghanistan, Indonesia, and Malaysia.
Mm-hmm.
Why there is a violence against Christians, Christian minorities that are, mm-hmm. for example, I give you the example of Pakistan. We were 5%
mm-hmm.
Christians when Pakistan came into existence in 1947. Now we are only 2%.
Mm-hmm.
We eat the same food. We believe the same.
Mm-hmm.
Why? So why there is a violence against Christian minority?
It's we can use easily, we can take religion. Religion is something that a lot of people can take and use it to justify their own understandings of what has been written and has been shared through our history. And there are individuals and there are groups that takes what is there and use the interpretation, their own interpretation, the historical interpretation, the traditional interpretation, to justify their own belief and to, more than that, to bring justification into the actions of what they feel towards someone or towards a group.
So if a religion teaches you, or your faith teaches you peace, and then it depends on individuals to interpret your own faith?
It could be that dimension, in where there is someone that can take from the content of the scriptures, either in the Quran or either in the Christian world, or even in the Jewish, in the Torah, the Quran, or the Bible. Historically, we have seen that happening, in where individuals bring their own individualistic interpretation of what they think this means as a whole, and then they present that as a godly definition that they bring that into being kind of sacred. So therefore, you need to attain to what is sacred, and then you need to follow that, and then you need to practice that, and then you need to live it. And when I see something like that, I take something like that, it can be could be a weapon.
Okay. There are five pillars in Islam. Everybody knows that. Okay. Pilgrimage is one of them.
Yeah.
As we heard the very bad news, 700 pilgrims doing Hajj, that pilgrimage, they were stampeded. Okay. And, but there's a sixth
pillars
in Islam, sixth one, that is not just obligatory, but it's obligatory, and that is jihad. Jihad has been defined in so many ways, but ask any scholar worth his salt, and he would say jihad is a holy war. Holy war against infidels. And it is also interpreted, if you are somehow sick, and if you are unable, and then you must provide support in the form of instruments or money or something to those who are doing the jihad. So where do you draw the line? Where, what happens? Why this jihad has to be, I don't know where you have been there, and a soldier that our army has trained in Afghanistan, he turns his gun on the very soldier, American soldier or NATO soldier that has trained him and given him the arms, and he is justifying that I am doing jihad. What is your take on that?
There is always, you know, from the perspective of myself as a military, there's always those that will look to infiltrate themselves into and make everybody believe that they are very sincere and honest into what they're looking to learn from, and then be able to come forward. It's like you said, where we draw the line. My experience, I was the only American chaplain that was walking through the streets of some of the villages in Kabul. I always carry my cross. I was identified as American mullah. I was embraced by an African community, by an African commander, and his very close force protection, the soldiers. And I was actually embraced in the house of a person that here, the title, the mayor of the city, there is the wakil, mm-hmm. who opened the doors of his house. I was, at the end of my tour, I was mm-hmm. adopted as mm-hmm. A spiritual son from one of the villages.
So you were called Mullah.
Yeah. American so Mullah. There were plenty of opportunities for them to come forward and use mm-hmm. What has been portrayed and projected and established in the Islam as the jihad and the holy war.
Why
at any particular moment they didn't.
Reverend Cammacho,
yeah.
Why we Americans, and I take pride in calling myself an American, why do we want Afghanistan to be modernized? There should be highways, there should be byways, there should be railways and mm-hmm. this. Why can't we let them live by their own traditions, by their own values, the way, and practice mm-hmm. their own faith?
Yeah.
Why we have to, isn't there a time to go in and time to get out?
Yes, there needs to be a time to get in, a time to get out, and there always need to be a plan.
Yes.
There needs to be a plan. You can go into a place without having a plan. But also you need to go into that place respecting what that place is and what gave identity, character to that place.
Exactly.
And you can take away from that place what belongs and identify them.
So what I deduce from what you are saying, and I agree and I have preached that, why impose our values mm-hmm. and our culture on other people who are completely different? Like East is East and West is West. The two will not, they run parallel. So why we have to educate, say our education is the best, our educational system, so follow this. Our way of living is this, you follow this. Why we have to impose? We should not, as you said clearly, and I beautifully you have explained, we should look at that geographical unit and try to understand and try to who they are, what they are, mm-hmm. why they are, and mm-hmm. within that domain, work with them.
Yes.
And that would gain respect, admiration mm-hmm. and love for the Americans.
You're right. When I go to a place with the belief and mentality, understanding that I am the best and what I have is the best of the best, and I'm providing, bringing the best of everything, then what I'm going to do is minimizing myself from understanding and seeing that what the other side brings mm-hmm. is also best of the best, mm-hmm. and that the experience that they have provided them with such an insightful knowledge and mm-hmm. understanding about so many different perspectives and dimensions of life.
Yeah. America goes into countries where they, at times, they do not have a plan, a clear cut.
Yes, sir.
Crystal plan, why we are going there, where we are going, the intelligence, sometimes we are fed wrong intelligence mm-hmm. on purpose,
yes.
misleading us to go there. But what I would like to ask you is, like our administration mm-hmm. and our president, Barack Hussein Obama, he has said it vocally, vociferously, administration has said that the terrorist should not be called Muslim terrorist. If it's a terrorist, is a Christian terrorist, he's a terrorist. Terrorist is a terrorist.
Yes,
and if we say, this terrorist is using his energy and everything in the name of Allah, so should we not call him a Muslim terrorist or a Christian terrorist?
That's what they call themselves. That's the way that they present themselves. It is not up to me to say that they're not what they call themselves.
Mm-hmm.
they call themselves Muslims, they call themselves believers of Islam,
yeah.
Then I need to understand that they're calling themselves Muslim and they're calling themselves believers of Islam in their way. I'm not the one. I understand from where the president is coming, but I'm not the one, neither the president, to say that they are not, because within the dimension of how they project and they understand religion, they are seeing that point of view in where they're calling, this is who I am and this is that I, what I believe.
I have many, many Muslim friends from all walks of life, and they're good people.
Yes, sir.
They're very, very good people, law-abiding citizens. Is it not fair to ask them, stand up and be counted? Words and actions speak louder. And then tell your friends, your relatives here that, hey, we have to, because we have to be okay in this. We have to be obedient and to law. And we should not take this, oh, I am Muslim, so this is my ID in the face kind of thing. So what would you ask Muslim friends what their responsibility as American citizen is to their own friends and relatives here?
Well, I can say that because I have been very involved with part of the Islam community, the Muslim community here in the county, specifically in the city, to continue presenting and to continue conscientizing individuals. I am, yes, I am a Muslim. I believe in the Islam. This is who I am. Because this here, these individuals here are saying, I am and I believe in, it doesn't mean that I had the right to say that everybody is the same. No. And to continue encouraging them to do what they're doing, I'm a very good friend with one of the community leaders who is Steve Sayed. And Steve Sayed has been very, one of the most advocated individuals about who, about what they are as a Muslim, and also in what they believe in regard to the Islam.
Would you believe Steve Marzuki has been on this show? That is about 2 years ago. And he was our guest last year at our wedding anniversary. And his wife is, and he's very much involved in interfaith harmony. And with that, I guess we have come to an end, and we must say, God bless America. God bless this land of the brave and the free that has given us all these opportunities. God bless you all, and God bless America.